Okay, let us start. We had received some questions which we could not answer in yesterday's lecture. So let's first begin with those set of questions. So first request which has come, it came from Mata Vaishno Devi University Katra, saying that please specify the meanings of symbols in writing while giving the expression so that we can relate easily. The thing is that, you know, most of the symbols at least which I have used are sort of standard. So therefore, I have not sort of defined. For example, you know, if I am using H, it's very clear it's Planck's constant. If I am using C, it's very clear that speed of light. But still, I will try to take care of this particular thing. K, for example, for Boltzmann constant. But you know, still, nevertheless, whenever it's possible, I will try to incorporate these things. Now, the second question is from Netaji Subhash Engineering College from Garia, Kolkata. Say, can you explain the term e to the power t to the power 5 in black body radiation curve? I'm not very sure what actually the question means. The basic thing is that, you know, you have, when we try to write a black body radiation curve, universal black body radiation curve. See, let me put it like that. Let me explain it something like this. That if you plot the radiation which is being emitted at a particular temperature, this is both a function of lambda as well as t. So if I take the total emissive power, plot as a function of, let us say, lambda, you will find that this is both a function of temperature and wavelength. So it means at this wavelength, the emission is slightly lower. As we increase lambda, emission becomes higher. At this particular value of lambda, the maximum power is emitted. Then it again keeps on going down. Now, this is also a function of temperature. If I increase the temperature, then you will find that this curve goes somewhere like this. And there is something which is Wien's displacement law, which says that this particular lambda m, where you see the maximum intensity, lambda m into t is constant. These are all the part of the black body radiation curve. Now, as we can see that this is basically a function of both lambda and t. However, if we plot what we have written in that particular figure, e lambda upon t to the power 5, t to the power 5 as a function of lambda t, all these curves can be merged into a single curve which becomes something like this. So this is what is called universal black body radiation curve. This is basically an experimental fact that all these curves which you are getting at different temperature, this is, let us say, T1, this is temperature T2. Okay. If you further increase temperature, it will probably shift, the maximum will shift to lower values. Okay. And of course, you know the Stefan's law which says that total area under the curve, it means total power radiated, will be proportional to T to the power 4. This is what is called Stefan's law. So there are various laws which are pertaining to the black body radiation curve, but the curve which I have drawn here was something which is called a universal black body radiation curve, because in this particular case, all these curves which you are plotting as a function of lambdas can be merged into a single curve. So this is just an experimental fact, nothing else. And this particular curve, as I was saying, that most of the other features one could have explained by using classical theory, other than the shape of this particular curve. And only for the explanation of the shape of this particular curve, eventually Planck had to make his hypothesis. Now, the second question which was there from College of Engineering, Bhuvaneshwar, does the flexibility of a bond depend on the pressure of the gas? Now, actually the bonds are little more complex than what we have mentioned. I am not 100% sure whether it does depend on the pressure of the gas, but you know, my gut feeling is that probably does not depend on the pressure of the gas, or the same question is for the vapors also, because whenever we are trying to approximate bonds by a sort of a harmonic forces, that is an approximation. The bonds are much more complex because it depends when you are bringing two atoms together, what are the forces which are actually leading to the bonding of the atoms, and also what are the forces which are repulsive forces. When you are bringing the atoms too close to each other. In fact, if you plot the force or potential energy diagram, it essentially shows something like this, curve something like this, and this is interatomic spacings, and let us say this is potential energy, and this particular curve, you know, is really not harmonic, so it is much more complex, it depends really on the interatomic forces. So normally, I would not expect that once you apply pressure, I mean, eventually what could happen that the mean value of x could change, but this shape of this particular curve, I mean, essentially is determined by what is this particular force which is the repulsive force and what is this particular force which is the attractive force. which is essentially responsible for forming the bond. Now, let me go to the next question, which is actually a question about, this is of course a comment saying that instead of giving bird's eye view over the quantum ideas, please take an idea. This is from Vellore, VIT Vellore. Please take an idea and give a real time example so that we can explain to our engineering students. See, basically, I have the quantum ideas, I have really given a bird's eye view. Basically, because I have a feeling that most of the students have studied this in their 12th standard. And why I want to repeat these things? Because essentially, I want them to follow a particular way of thinking, and therefore, I put them in my perspective so that I can eventually lead to the proper quantum mechanics. When I actually come to the quantum mechanics, which is a topic which is probably new for the students, there I'll be much more rigorous. But here, for example, if I want to explain, let's say, black body radiation curve on its own self, or for that matter, let's say, specific heat of solids, or for that matter, photoelectric effect or Bohr's model, this itself becomes a part of the course. While most of the students in their 12th standard, in some way, they are aware of these things. And they are not really pertaining, they are not really very important to the main feature, main theme of these lectures, which are essentially leading to the quantum mechanics. The only one thing which I have mentioned and which I will be doing later is the Compton effect, because Compton effect required a little bit of understanding of relativity. And because of our logistic issues, we are going to do relativity later after we finish the quantum mechanics portion. So at that time, I will revisit the Compton effect. Other than that, that would be my say. If you are really interested in some of the basic quantum ideas to be explored, I don't think this is possible as far as the scope of this workshop is concerned. Maybe one has to conduct a different workshop to give details of, let's say, Bohr's model or black body radiation or whatever it is. Now, next question is from Rangaswamy College of Technology, Namakkal, Tamil Nadu. If light is considered as a particle, how color can be classified? Actually, this is an interesting question, but remember color, see, light is classified for a wave, it can also be classified for the case of photons, for the particle nature, because see, the color perception is more of a physiological thing, okay, how the signal comes to the light and how the brain actually deciphers this particular thing and gives the signal of color. I don't think in any way it depends on whether you are talking of the wave nature or you are talking of the particle nature. See, eventually we can always talk of the frequency also in the photon, because it talks of basically of the energy, okay. Now, energy and frequency both are related as far as the wave particle and the particle aspects of the light is concerned. So, like we can start talk of perception of color as far as the wave nature is concerned, we can exactly talk in the same way of the perception of the color of a photon. The next question is from Noida, JP, Institute of Information Technology, regarding the experimental evidence of black body radiation curve. This black body radiation curve is only an experimental curve, it's not a theoretical curve. So, there is no question of a experimental evidence. This is what has been experimentally observed. People had performed the experiment by taking bodies which can be approximately treated as a black body. And for that, black body was generally treated as a cavity. In fact, one of the ideal way of dealing a cavity was something like this, where you have a small cavity with a very, very small hole in this. So, any radiation which falls within this particular cavity always gets reflected back, and this particular it never has a chances of coming out. So, this is a body which absorbs all the radiation essentially which is coming out of it, and then you have this particular hole because you want to watch what is the radiation which is being emitted by this particular thing. So, that is why we always talk of cavity when we talk of black body radiation. But on the other hand, the curve which I have mentioned here, this particular curve is actually an experimental curve, okay, and what was actually required was to theoretically explain this particular curve, and that is how the Planck's model come into picture. Now, next question is from Bhilai Institute of Technology, Durg, Chhattisgarh. Is there any phenomenon which describes both particle and wave nature simultaneously? The thing is that this was generally called complementarity principle. I think it was first proposed by Bohr's, which says that both these models, both light particle and the wave model, cannot be simultaneously observed. However, as far as I know, this particular thing has been questioned quite a bit recently, and there are some groups who have been doing some experiments to see whether this particular complementarity principle really works. But as of now, general belief is that you cannot observe both the phenomenon together unless we are very, very sure and experimentally it is proved conclusively that it can be done. Then the next question is from Knowledge Institute of Technology, Kakapalayam in Salem. is massive particle can emit de Broglie wave even though if the velocity of the particle is less than c. Of course, you know, the de Broglie relationship is correct even in the case of relativistic particles. But you know, here we always talk of non-relativistic particle. In fact, the quantum mechanics that we are going to describe is purely non-relativistic, and this lambda is equal to h by p, okay, is valid both when particle is, it is a relativistic particle or non-relativistic particle. Only thing, the relationship between momentum and the velocity, one has to take a relativistic expression about which we will discuss later when we come to the theory of relativity. But whether we are using classical or whether you are using the relativistic expression, this expression lambda is equal to h upon p is always correct. Now, it says massive particle can emit de Broglie wavelength. I don't know, there is nothing like emission of the de Broglie wavelength. It is supposed to be a wave which is associated with the particle. So, there is no question of emission of absorption. This is just a particle possess that wave type of property. Now, this we are going to discuss later probably in the tomorrow's lectures, that when we are talking of the wave property, what does this wave mean? Because see, when we say for example a mechanical wave, we know that mechanical wave, it means the vibration of the atoms or vibration of molecules. When we are talking of electromagnetic wave, we know that the variation that we are talking is actually the variation of the electric field or the magnetic field. Okay. But when we say that this is a wave, particle wave or de Broglie wave associated with the particle, what is the nature of that wave, what is oscillating there, this particular thing we are going to discuss in our later classes. The next question is, Sri Ramakrishna Institute of Technology from Coimbatore, is it possible to combine two wave packets? Of course, yes. In fact, this is one of the most important things which I will be discussing today, is that you must be able to merge these two wave packets. See, if we cannot merge, we cannot have interference, we cannot have diffraction, because essentially it is overlap of the two wave packets. So, the two wave packets can definitely be overlapped, and this is one aspect which eventually will lead to the type of Schrodinger equation that we are going to discuss. So, this is an important aspect, and superposition principle that two waves can superimpose on each other is a very, very important aspect and which has to be possible, and this is possible. Then another question is again from IIT University Vellore, says we are aware that Stefan Boltzmann law holds good for all wavelengths. In what way it matches with the Rayleigh-Jeans law? As I had mentioned even in the earlier thing, the Rayleigh-Jeans law essentially tries to tell what is the spectral distribution of the emissive power, which means, of course, this is not really Rayleigh-Jeans curve, but you know, this is a sort of a experimental curve. Now, this is actually spectral distribution. It tells what power is emitted, how much power is emitted for a given wavelength. Now, Stefan's law talks irrespective of the wavelength. It means it talks of the total power emitted irrespective of what is the wavelength. So, if this particular curve is integrated, then we will get the total power which is emitted at a given temperature. Similarly, if I integrate this particular curve, this will tell me the total power which is emitted at this particular temperature. And as I mentioned, that this particular power which is emitted will be proportional to T to the power 4, sigma T to the power 4, and that is the Stefan's law. So, Stefan's law talk of the total power emitted. So, essentially what we have been writing as E lambda d lambda, I have to integrate it from 0 to infinity. Then what I will get is the total power emitted, and that is what turns out to be proportional to sigma t to the power 4. So, Stefan's law, again let me repeat, is the integral of all the wavelengths. Okay. We take the total power emitted, while when we are talking of Rayleigh-Jeans law or when we are talking of universal black body radiation curve, at that time we are looking at the power as a function of wavelength. Okay. We are looking little more finer, we are going little more finer and trying to find out how much power is emitted at a given for a given wavelength. The next question is from O.P. Jindal Institute of Technology, Raigarh. From the experimental details of hydrogen gas, Cv is equal to 3.5 R, while for solids it is 3 R. Why the gas is higher than solid? Of course, this depends, because it depends on the total degrees of freedom. Because in the case of diatomic molecule, as we have seen, okay, we have basically 5 degrees of freedom if this is rigid. If this is not rigid, then we have 6 degrees of freedom. And 6 degrees of freedom, one of them is vibrational. So, you have 5 corresponding to rotational or translational and 1 corresponding to vibrational. So, we have said 5 by 2 kT multiplied by Na, of course, plus this is kT multiplied by Na. So this gives you 7 by 2 kT, which when you differentiate with respect to temperature, you get 7 by 2 R. On the other hand, in the case of gas molecule, there is only 3 degrees of freedom, because each atom can only have vibration and it has 3 degrees of freedom. So obviously, the specific heat turns out to be lesser. So there is nothing, no contradiction there, here. The next question is from University BDT College of Engineering from Devangere in Karnataka. What is the substantiation for zero rest mass of the photon? This particular aspect we will discuss when we discuss about relativity, because obviously in the classical physics there is no place for having a particle with zero rest mass. But you know, as we will be seeing when we are talking about relativity, we can define a sort of a mass which depends on the speed when we are talking about relativity. So it is possible, relativity gives an option where it is possible that where rest mass can be zero and this particular particle can still possess energy and momentum. Of course, it could still not be present, okay, but there is a possibility that with m naught is equal to 0, there is a, the particle could possess energy and momentum, and then of course, the only condition is that it must travel with the speed of light. So let me sort of postpone answering this question until the time when we are doing special theory of relativity, and of course, at that time, you know, you can ask the question again if you have doubts. Next question is from Don Bosco College of Engineering and Technology, Azara in Guwahati. In the Rayleigh's curve, what is the physical significance of the wavelength temperature product? Again, as I have mentioned that in this particular curve, this is an experimental curve. It so happens that using this particular way of expressing this particular way, we are able to unify the all the curves which you would have obtained at different values of temperature. So let me just, so all the curves that we would have obtained at various temperatures, they can all be unified into one single curve if instead of this particular E lambda and lambda, we plot E lambda upon T to the power 5 as a function of lambda T. This is purely an experimental way of looking into it, and it essentially makes it life simple because there is only one single curve which you have to bother about. Last question is from MGM College of Engineering, Nanded. Cv is equal to 5 by 2 R for rigid molecules, but you say that for flexible molecules is Cv is equal to 7 by 2 R, but according to the formula, degrees of freedom is equal to 3 minus constraints, that is 2 molecules degrees of freedom, which is equal to 5, which I just now explained. Okay, let me just try to do once more. See, we have 5 degrees of freedom if we assume that this length does not change. If this length does not change, because 3 degrees of freedom for this, 3 degrees of freedom for this, and there is one constraint which says that the distance between the center of masses of the molecules must remain constant. In that case, I will have 5 degrees of freedom. In that case, I will always get specific heat to be equal to 5 by 2 R. On the other hand, if I say that this particular bond is not very rigid and there is a possibility that the length of this particular bond can change, it means it can vibrate, the atoms can vibrate. So, it can, the distance can go like this or can become larger while in the vibration. Then this particular constraint no longer holds good because the length of the bond is no longer constant. So, the distance between the two atoms will not be constant. So, that constraint is removed. So, you still have 6 degrees of freedom, but one of the degrees of freedom becomes vibrational because in order that this particular length changes, it can change only if the length of this particular bond changes, and the length of this particular bond will change only when these atoms will vibrate. Okay, and we have said for vibration, there is also average of half kT energy for potential energy and half kT for kinetic energy. Therefore, for that particular degrees of freedom, that particular degree of freedom, we will have on the average kT degree kT rather than 3 by 2 kT. So, for 5 degrees of freedom, we will have 5 into half kT, and for this last degree of freedom, we will have 1 into kT. This you must multiply by Na because there are total number of Na number of molecules. So, this will be the total energy, and you take dE by dt, this will be 7 by 2 R. On the other hand, if this was not present and this term will not be present, if the molecules are rigid, because then this constraint is applicable and then we have only 5 degrees of freedom. In that case, the specific heat will be equal to 5 by 2 R. Okay, so I think these are all the questions that we had received through the chat mechanism, and there are some questions which had come by mails, which also I think I have tried to answer. Now, let us come back to our lecture. Let us start with recapitulating what we did last time. We first discussed the concept of localized wave packet, and we said that it is a localized wave packet which actually represents a realistic wave. Okay. An ideal wave is infinite, both in position and time, and that does not exist in nature. What exists in nature is only a localized wave packet, and that is why I call this as a realistic wave. Then we discuss that in order to generate a realistic wave, I have to consider a large number of ideal waves, which are obviously, as just now mentioned, are infinite, but they must also vary in their wavelengths. So, if we mix such type of waves together, it is possible to get a localized wave packet. We also talk a little bit about the Fourier transform, saying that how, if I know a particular wave packet, I can find out what type of waves it is consisting of, what type of ideal wave it is consisting of. Then we sort of briefly mentioned that wave packet must travel with the group speed, and this in the case of de Broglie wave turns out to be equal to the speed of the particle. This particular aspect I have not discussed, probably we will discuss in one of the problem sessions, that this particular wave packet would travel with the speed of the particle. Then we discussed about the double slit experiment and try to understand this double slit experiment, which we understand very well on the basis of the wave nature, try to mix up the particle model. We try to think that these particles, we sort of discussed in the case of electrons, these electrons can be treated as particle, which we know that they can be treated. Okay. Then we try to interpret the same experiment using the particle nature, and then when we do this particular thing, we landed up into difficulty. We found out that there is certain point on the screen where when we had only one slit open, certain number of particles were coming. When we open both the slits, a smaller number of particles started reaching there, which cannot be understood, because if I would have opened the other slit, if I have provided one more way for the particles to come and reach the screen, the number of the particles reaching there must increase. In other words, that interference, which is basically classically considered as a wave property, where it is possible to get a reduced intensity or zero intensity when the two waves come and interact with each other and have a destructive interference, I will not be able to understand purely from the particle nature, because the particle nature tells that if certain number of particles are coming from one slit, and if I have opened the second slit, at least the number of the particles would remain constant, but there is no way that it can go down. So, we have difficulty in understanding, and then we realize, I mean, this is what we have said, we cannot understand how the number of particles reaching a particular point on the screen can reduce when both the slits are open. It obviously means that we have to look at slightly different way into the nature, and if we are trying to have a wave particle duality, then we will not be able to understand it that well as we are able to understand. Then finally, we talked a little bit about the uncertainty principle. We talked that how this wave particle duality would lead into an uncertainty principle. So, this is the thing which I was trying to tell, that if you are taking this particular point here, initially a large number of points, or let us say this particular point, when only one slit was open, you are getting a very large number of points here, large number of particles here, but when both the slits are open, you suddenly start getting a very small number of particles, okay, which in the case of wave mechanism, we can understand as a destructive interference, but it is very, very difficult to understand it on the basis of a particle model, because here we are having very large number of particles. By opening the second slit, as if it appears that the electrons have decided not to reach there, okay, and even though if this slit was closed, a larger number of electrons would have reached this particular point. Okay. And as I mentioned, that this experiment, even if it is done so slowly that electrons are coming only one by one, still you will see that these type of interference patterns will be seen. Now, let us go ahead. Let us try to see whether we can watch these electrons in this particular experiment. If you want to watch electrons, difficult, as I said, but it is a sort of a thought experiment. So, let us assume that we can watch these electrons. So, what we can do, that let us try to really see whether the electrons are coming. This hypothesis, the original hypothesis that we have put, that electrons coming from slit S1 or slit S2. Okay. Then, let me put a light source here, somewhere a light source, and wherever there is an electron which is passing from slit S1, and I see an electron which is reaching here, I can always find out whether this electron has reached from this particular slit. If a light flash is seen and close to this particular slit, then and an electron reaches here, then we know that this electron is the one which has passed through slit S2. So, all the electrons which are reaching here, I will be able to classify whether they are coming from slit S1 or S2. So, let us try to do that particular experiment of sort of watching. Let me put watch under the quotes, let us try to watch these electrons. So, can we verify experimentally if the particles indeed go through one of the two slits when both the slits are open? So, put a light source to watch the electron. So, just put a light source and try to see whether it is really going through slit S1 or through slit S2. When you do this experiment, you will really find that any electron which is reaching on this particular screen has definitely come either through slit S1 or through slit S2. It has something, some wonderful thing has not happened, so that you can see that electrons are coming from somewhere else. They definitely have passed either through slit S1 or through slit S2 in order that they reach this particular screen. Okay? But on the other hand, in this particular condition, if you perform the experiment by opening both the slits, you will find that the interference pattern will be lost. You will not be able to see the interference pattern. We shall indeed find that the electrons will pass through one of the two slits, but now interference will be lost. Interference pattern will be lost. When both these slits are open, you will actually notice that they are no longer interfering. Okay, you will just see N1, 2 will be equal to just N1 plus N2. Okay, then you will think, what has happened? You know, earlier when I was not watching these electrons, everything was fine. I was seeing interference pattern, but now once I have started looking at those electrons, now I am finding that the interference pattern is lost. Okay. Then we suddenly realize, okay, of course, photons also, light sources also consisting of photons, which are also particles, and therefore, these photons which have also energy probably can interact with these electrons, and therefore, they have changed the path of electrons or whatever has happened, and essentially we have what we say that the experiment has been perturbed. The condition of the experiments earlier has become different from this, because I have put a light source and this particular light source has perturbed the experiment. And this perturbation has caused the interference pattern to be destroyed. Then we may think that, okay, let me try to do the other thing, let me try to reduce the perturbation. So, what I do, instead of using photons of higher energy, let me go and try to reduce the energy of the photons. It means I start using higher and higher wavelength, because higher wavelength would be having a lower energy. Higher wavelength will mean lower frequency, will mean a lower energy. So, let us try to use lower and lower frequency or higher and higher wavelength photons in order to observe these particular electrons. When you try to do that, you will find, okay, so long you are seeing the flashes, you will definitely find that the electrons are coming through slit S1 or slit S2, okay, and you will not be able to see interference pattern. But if you keep on reducing the energy of the photon, the wavelength will keep on increasing, and a situation will come that you remember the resolving power depends on the wavelength. Okay. If the wavelength is very, very large, we cannot resolve two particles which are separated at a distance, which are typically order much lesser than the wavelength of the light that is being used to watch them. And in that particular case, you will find that you will see a particular flash of light coming from here, okay, because you are using very, very large wavelength of light, and you will not be able to detect whether the electron is coming from S1 or S2. In that case only, my perturbation will be lesser enough, least enough, so that I will be able to re-obtain my interference pattern. Basically, what I am trying to say, that is not possible to perform an experiment by which you are sure that the electrons are coming from N1 and slit S1 or S2, and also observe the interference pattern together. So, if I use low energy photons, we can reduce the perturbation by using low energy photons. If wavelength increases beyond a limit, the resolving power would be reduced and the two slits may appear as one broad slit. Only in such circumstances, we shall be able to get back the interference pattern. The perturbation will be small enough so as not to disturb the original experiment. Now, what sometimes it appears that uncertainty principle talks only about the perturbation of the experiment. This is not really a correct concept, because perturbation was known even classically. For example, if there is a circuit, electrical circuit, this is some circuit, if I want to measure, let us say, voltage between this particular point, these two particular points, then what I do, I connect a voltmeter here. Okay. But once I add a voltmeter here, then you find that the current in the circuit changes. When the current in the circuit changes, then this is no longer the original experiment. So, you have perturbed the experiment. Similarly, if I want to measure the current here in this particular branch, okay, then this ammeter that I am putting will have a finite resistance, and if it has a finite resistance, this will alter the current. So, you are no longer having the original value of the current. So, you have perturbed the experiment. So, people think that this particular uncertainty principle is related to perturbation. But remember, in classical physics, we always think that there is always a possibility of reducing the perturbation as much as we want and eventually get as accurate values as we want. That is the way we always work it out. On the other hand, in the case of uncertainty principle, this is a sort of a fundamental principle. This is not related just to the perturbation, but it's related, linked between two different quantities. One is position and momentum. See, as far as position is concerned, we can also argue the same thing, that we can always imagine that having better and better experiments, I could be able to measure the position as accurately as I want. But when I try to do that, I will have to make momentum uncertain. Similarly, if I want to measure momentum very, very accurately, then given the best type of instruments, maybe I will be able to measure momentum as precisely as I want. But when I make a measurement, I will find that the position uncertainty becomes much larger. So, here we have two linked things, okay. In that way, it is different from the simple perturbation that we are used to talking about in the case of classical physics. So, this is what I have said. Perturbing an experiment while performing in measurement is known also in classical physics. But in quantum physics, this comes as a basic requirement, and it is coupled to two simultaneous measurements. So, I want to measure momentum, simultaneously I want to measure the position. Okay, if I want to measure position as accurately, I could do it, but at that time when I want to measure momentum, momentum will become much more uncertain. If I want to measure momentum very accurately, I could still be able to do it, but then at the same time I will not be able to measure position that accurately. So, these are two linked things, and this is much more fundamental concept. This is basically a fundamental concept of physics. Now, let us try to, rather hurriedly try to get some idea of the uncertainty product. What is the order of magnitude of the uncertainty product? I will use two different methods, get an idea of what is the uncertainty product. So, one method is using wave packet approach. Remember, when I am calculating this particular uncertainty here, I am only evaluating the order of magnitude just to find out how large is the order of magnitude. Okay, this is not really an exact way of calculation. Okay, when we go, immediately after that, I will define uncertainty much more accurately, and then I will try to talk about these things in a much more precise sense. But at this particular moment, we are trying to do just an order of magnitude calculation. So, let us go back to the old Beats problem and make certain assumptions, some simplified assumptions, to just get an idea. When I am talking of measurement of position and momentum, this product delta x and delta p x, uncertainty in position and uncertainty in momentum, their product, what is that order of? Okay, what we will realize that the order is very, very small, which is typically of the order of Planck's constant, which is what we call as h. So, let us go to the Beats problem. Now, we take only one modulation of the wave packet. So, remember, see, this is what we had done about the Beats. This is the old picture which I had shown yesterday. When we superimpose two waves, one corresponding to k equal to k, another corresponding to k is equal to k plus delta k, then we get this particular pattern. But this is not really a completely localized wave packet, because we have used only two wavelengths. We have used just two values of k. So, it is, it is not at all localized, because this particular oscillations will continue right from minus infinity to plus infinity, all right. But let us assume, let us concentrate our attention only on one of these modulations. So, let us just take, which I have grayed this particular area, that let us assume that this is the only wave packet, we ignore other wave packet. And let us assume that I am not using only two values of k, but I am taking two limits, one is k, another is k plus delta k, and I am mixing all the wavelengths between k and k plus delta k in order to generate a localized wave packet, which is of this particular shape, which is given by the grayed area. Okay. So, I am assuming that whatever I am getting here is actually a result of combining a very large number, infinite number of wavelengths ranging between k and k plus delta k. So, this is my assumption, which I am not justifying, because my idea is only to get an order of magnitude of the uncertainty product, not doing any exact calculation as of now. So, this is what I say. assume that one modulation of the wave packet can be treated by mixing waves of not just two wavelengths, but all the wavelengths between k and k plus delta k, just to give you, as I said, an approximation. Now, I of course assume that this particular wave packet which I have generated is one of the modulation which has been obtained as a result of this particular equation. Okay? So, we estimate the order of magnitude by using this particular method. Now, if I look at this particular envelope of this particular modulation, we have seen earlier that this particular modulation is given by this quantity in the square bracket. While this sine k term, which is larger k and therefore smaller wavelength, is actually are these oscillations or these oscillations. So, these are my sine terms and this is the term which is in my square bracket, which has lead to a variation of the amplitude. All right. Now, using this particular amplitude, let us try to estimate what is the value of uncertainty product. So, what will be our way of looking into it? See, because this physical wave packet, I am assuming it extends from here to here. So, whatever is the envelopes lambda by 2, half of the wavelength, that will be the physical extent of this particular wave packet. Let me repeat, I assume my wave packet consists of only this particular modulation. So, my uncertainty in the position of the particle will be somewhere between this and this. So, the order of uncertainty in position is this. Because as we have discussed last time, if I perform an experiment here, I will be able to detect the property of the particle. If I am able to perform the experiment here, I will be able to detect the property of the particle, but not here. If somebody performs an experiment here, does not see this particular modulation. So, they will not be able to detect the property of the particle there. So, it means the uncertainty in the position of the particle is given by this much amount. All right. So, let us calculate what will be the value of delta x, which I can calculate very easily by knowing the wavelength of this particular modulation, which is the wavelength of that particular expression in the square bracket, this particular square bracket. So, I know what is the value of wavelength because I know the k is delta k by 2. So, I can calculate what will be the lambda of this particular modulation. Once I know the lambda of this particular modulation, I know that this is half lambda because this curve will go like this and then go like this. So, that will be lambda. So, here will be the lambda by 2. Okay? So, I calculate this lambda by 2. Then I know what is the value of k's that I have used. I have used values of k starting from k to k plus delta k. So, I know what is the uncertainty in the value of k, which is delta k, okay, which I will relate to the uncertainty in momentum using de Broglie relationship. So, let us just try to do that. So, first let me try to express this delta p. You know, p is by de Broglie relationship is given by h by lambda. I multiply this by 2 and divide by this by 2 pi. So, I multiply by 2 pi, divide by 2 pi. So, this becomes 2 pi h, this becomes 2 pi lambda. Now, h by 2 pi is called h cross or h bar, which is here. All right. Then, 2 pi by lambda is called k. So, this expression, of course, h cross or h bar is constant. So, this will just be h bar delta k. So, uncertainty in the momentum can be written as just h cross or h bar multiplied by delta k. Now, as I said, position uncertainty can be evaluated from the wavelength of the modulation. Now, if I take the wavelength of the modulation, this will be 2 pi divided by the k of the modulation. K of the modulation is delta k by 2. So, this is delta k by 2. Remember this particular thing. See, the k of the, see, expression is k x minus omega t. So, k is delta k by 2. So, the wave vector of this particular expression is delta k by 2. So, this is what I am using here. So, this is delta k by 2 and because I want to convert this into wavelength. So, this will be 2 pi by k and k is delta k by 2. So, this becomes 2 multiplied by 2 pi divided by delta k. This will be the wavelength and I have to use half of its wavelength. So, I just putting half. Okay. If you just take this particular expression, this 2 will cancel from this. This will just be 2 pi delta k. So, I see that delta p will be h cross delta k. Delta x will be 2 pi by delta k. If I multiply delta p into delta x, what you will find out that this delta k will cancel. This will be h cross multiplied by 2 pi, which means just it will be equal to h, the Planck's constant. So, we see this purely an estimate of uncertainty product that, I mean, as I mentioned, that uncertainties are always an uncertainty principle as always is always written as the product delta x and delta p of what is the order of delta x and delta p. the product of delta x and delta p. So we see that delta x and delta p is of the order of h. So you can see that this particular product is exceedingly small, and that is the reason that this uncertainty we are never able to detect in our real life. The Planck's constant being so small, we are not able to see this particular effect of uncertainty principle in, let's say, macroscopic particle, bigger particle, let's say in cricket ball or whatever it is. It's only when we are going to that particular limit of small particles that I will be able to get a feeling of this uncertainty principle. The effect of this uncertainty principle will be seen, or the effect of wave particle duality will be seen only when we are talking in that particular limit. Now, let me just estimate by using another particular way of doing this particular thing. This is also another interesting way of doing it. So, let us just discuss this particular aspect, which is the wave particle duality approach. Now, we just now considered what we call as a double slit experiment. Now, let us consider a single slit diffraction. This particular idea I had used earlier, if you remember, when we are trying to talk about N1 and N2. See, when we are talking about this particular curve of N1 and N2, at that time we said that this will show a sort of diffraction effect. Okay. Now, let us consider that there is only one slit, there are no two slits, and therefore, we are only seeing this particular diffraction effect. Let us try to understand this particular behavior on the basis of wave particle duality, and this will also bring some interesting application or interesting consequence of uncertainty principle, about which I have found generally most of the students being confused. So, now we consider a single slit diffraction of a beam of monoenergetic particles. Okay, these particles, again, we can treat electrons for our sake. I mean, these particles have to be quantum particles, tiny particles, like fundamental particles. Okay, let us assume electrons as those particles, and interpret this on the basis of uncertainty principle and define the order of product. That is what I am going to do next. So, this is our single slit experiment. Now, I do not have any two slits. I have just a wall in which I have a single slit, and let us assume that this particular width of this particular slit is d. Again, like before, I have a source of particles, let us say source of electrons, and then I have a screen on the top of it. Then, as you know, the single diffraction, in a normal situation, this particular beam should directly hit, but there is always a bending, and you will find that this particular thing shows you what we call as a diffraction pattern. And you will find the smaller is the value of d, the larger will be the value of theta, the angular separation between the maximum and the first minimum. And this particular separation is given by the standard expression d sin theta is equal to n lambda, okay, where d, n will correspond to first separation, second separation, etcetera, etcetera. This is a very standard single slit diffraction experiment, which normally people are expected to know at the time of high school. Now, what I would like to interpret again, like the Young's double slit experiment, trying to explain this on the basis of particle, invoke my uncertainty principle, trying to understand this on the basis of sort of both wave particle duality, try to somewhere invoke particle nature, somewhere invoke wave nature, and eventually from that derive the, not really derive, but get an order of an estimate of the uncertainty product. That is what I will do now. So, let us first understand this particular experiment. Of course, this is a consequence, as you know, that smaller is the slit width, the larger will be the width of the central maximum. The experiment can be understood well by the wave theory. Now, let us try to bring the particle nature, assuming that the experiment is being performed with a particle. Of course, even light is that, in that sense, is sort of particles. But as I say, for light, we always have a very hazy view in our mind. So, we are not so much concerned. But when we try to talk about electrons, which we know classically as a particle, then only we start getting these shocking effects. Okay, so let us assume that you have some source of particles, which is, let us say, infinite distance away. So, let us suppose that this particular source of the particle is very, very far off, it is infinite distance away. So, if the source of the particles is infinite distance away, essentially the particles which are reaching here, they will all be parallel. Okay. Let us call this direction as y, this direction as x direction. So, essentially it will mean that the velocity of these particular electron, because I am assuming that this source is pushed to infinite. So, all the electrons will be having velocity only in the x direction, and therefore, the y component of the velocity Vy will be 0, and will be quite certain as, or let me put it like that in the language of the calculus, as this particular source moves to the infinity, the y component of the velocity will tend to 0. Okay, and then of course, uncertainty when we are very sure that the y component is 0, the uncertainty in the y component of the velocity is also 0. So, this is what I have written there. Assume that the source is infinite distance away, therefore, electrons are moving purely in x direction. Therefore, delta p y, which essentially means y, because p y is related to mass into velocity, okay, delta p y is equal to 0, and obviously, delta y by uncertainty principle would mean infinite. It essentially means that in this particular case, you are never sure whether the particle, if the uncertainty principle has to be holding good, because your delta p y is 0, it means delta y has to be infinite, it means the particle could land anywhere here. It could be here, it could be here, it could come somewhere anywhere here. The uncertainty in the y component will be infinite, which also you can understand because this source has been pushed infinite distance away. So, a particular particle which is being emitted from here may land up at this particular point, may land up in this particular point, may land up anywhere here. So, therefore, as per uncertainty principle, the y component of the velocity is 0 and uncertainty in its position along the y direction is infinite. So, this is what I said. Hence, we are not sure about the y position of the particle at all. Now, what happens when suddenly these particles encounter a slit? Up till wall, it was perfectly all right, but suddenly these particles encounter the screen, this particular wall, and they encounter a slit. Now, when electron is passing through this particular slit, suddenly it finds that its uncertainty has been limited to something of the order of d. Now, we are very sure that an electron which has reached from here, okay, could have gone, must have gone from this particular slit, because now there is no other way. Unlike double slit experiment where there was another possibility of electron being going from somewhere else, the electron is only going from here. So, when at the instant when the electron was passing through the slit, suddenly it finds that the uncertainty in the y position has become finite, because we are very sure that the particle's uncertainty in position is of the order of d. Of course, the particle could have gone slightly up, could have gone slightly down, but it has to be within the slit, and therefore, at that instant of time, the uncertainty in position has been reduced from infinite value to d value. What would that mean in the language of uncertainty principle? That delta p y, which was earlier infinite, has also has to go down. So, delta y is finite. So, delta p y cannot be 0. It means now, when the particle is coming here, it will suddenly, because its y component cannot be 0. So, therefore, some particles may start developing totally in an unpredictable manner a y component of the velocity. Some electrons may acquire a y component of the velocity in this direction, some may acquire in this particular direction. Okay. So, earlier when we were very sure that v y was 0, it is no longer sure as the particles have just started passing through the slit. See, delta y has suddenly become, as particles are passing through the slit, delta y has suddenly been made finite. Hence, delta p y cannot also be 0 anymore. Hence, the particles, I mean, this is very, very important sentence to realize. Hence, the particles would pick up a y component of the momentum in a totally unpredictable and uncontrolled manner. These two words are extremely important. Okay? It means, in classical mechanics, we are always talking of predictability. Okay? If we know the initial conditions, then we know where the particle is at t is equal to 0, we know precisely, if I know the forces, what will be the position of the particle at t is equal to 1 second. It is 100% predictable in classical mechanics. In quantum mechanics, that is what does not happen. Okay, things are not predictable. Okay, that is what is uncertainty about. Okay, so, once the particular particle is coming here, then I do not know what value of y component of the momentum it will pick up. Some may pick up larger, some may pick up smaller, some may go positive, some may go negative. Okay, but on the other hand, it's totally unpredictable and totally uncontrolled. I cannot control. Okay, in what value of y component of the momentum this particular electron will pick up? So let me read again. Hence, the particles will pick up a y component of the momentum in a totally unpredictable and uncontrolled manner. Smaller the slit width, smaller will be the uncertainty in y, and therefore larger will be the uncertainty in the momentum. All right. So, essentially, as you can see, that this falls in line with whatever we have seen from the wave theory. It means the p y component will become larger and larger. So, the velocities in the y direction will tend to become larger and larger. Of course, you can always ask me a question, which is probably a correct question, that if I know electron has reached here, okay, can't I find out the y component of its velocity very, very exactly? I can of course find out, because I can find out how much distance is this and how much time this particular particle would have taken to reach this particular distance. Okay, if I know Vy, Vx, then of course I can find out what will be the value of Vy, and I can find it pretty accurately from my calculation. But that's not what uncertainty principle talks about. Uncertainty principle talks about when this particular particle was passing through this thing, could I have predicted what will be the value of Vy? The answer is that I could not have predicted. Okay, one particular particle would have picked up this particular value of velocity so that it landed the particle here. Another particle would pick up a velocity of y component so that it lands up here. Third particle may land up here. Fourth particle may land up here. And I cannot predict, I cannot control, I cannot prejudge and say that, okay, this particular particle which is now passing through the slit will now pick up this specific value of Vy, and therefore it will land here or here or here. Once it has landed there, of course we can find it out. But I cannot predict. So that's the reason I had emphasized this particular aspect of predictability and controlling. I cannot predict and I cannot control, while in the case of Newton's law of motion, I could have predicted the thing. So that's why I have put the question, what about Newton's law? In Newton's law, I would have predicted if there is no force on the particle must keep on going straight. Okay? If it has deviated from its path, okay, obviously there has to be a force on it. And then once I know the force, I can predict where this particular particle will land up. That's what was the classical mechanics, that's what was Newton's law. But now, because of this mixture of wave particle duality, I hope you can appreciate, because there is a mixture of wave particle duality, therefore you see that this particular particle will totally in a random fashion, totally in uncontrollable fashion, will pick up a y component of the velocity, which I will not be able to control. Now, let us use the wave formula to predict the order of uncertainty product. Let's assume that electrons land themselves only in the central maximum of the diffraction pattern. Again, I am doing an order of magnitude calculation. So, I am ignoring these other wings here, which I am getting here. So, I am ignoring these particular wings here. Okay. So, I am assuming that the electron is landing only here. Anyway, this particular part is the most intense part. So, what I will try to do, how much is the component Vy required to put this particular particle, let's say here. Okay. I will calculate from this. This will be my delta Y. From this, I will try to calculate what will be the value of delta Vy. From that, I will try to calculate delta Py and eventually take the uncertainty product delta Y into delta Py. So, first let us try to calculate the time taken by the electron to reach the screen after passing through the slit. Okay. L is supposed to be the distance between the slit and the screen. So, let me just redefine things. This was L. This is the distance between the wall and the screen. Remember, this distance, this is the slit width, this is d, theta is the angle corresponding to the angular separation between the maximum and the minimum. Y naught is the distance in the screen, on the screen, between the maximum, central maximum and the first minimum. Okay. So, we have to remember these things, this theta, y naught, d, l, there are four quantities I have defined, l distance. D is the separation between the width, the slit width, theta is the angular separation, y naught is the distance seen on the screen. So, if I assume that the particle were coming with a velocity Vx in the x direction, then the time it will take for the particles to reach the screen after they have just crossed the slit will be L by Vx. This is the time these particles will take. During this time, the electrons also gets displaced along the y direction due to the random velocity acquired after passing through the slit due to uncertainty principle. This is what we have just now discussed, that uncertainty principle causes these particular particles to pick up randomly a y component of the velocity. So, because of that, there will be displacement of the particles along the y direction. If Vy is the y component needed to take an electron to the end point of the central maximum, this is what I have earlier said. So, y naught is the distance of the first minimum from the central maximum. And let us assume that Vy is the velocity component in the y direction, which is required for the electron to reach at that particular point. Then I can find out this y naught must be equal to, see, this L upon Vx was the time, and Vy was the y component of the velocity developed. Okay. So, velocity multiplied by time will be the distance that it will travel along the y direction. okay, and this must be equal to the y naught. So, this I am writing y naught is equal to L v y upon v x. Now, I am multiplying by mass to convert into momentum, because uncertainty principle is expressed in terms of momentum. So, I have multiplied by m. So, this m p y, m v y becomes p y, and in denominator we have m times v x. So, y naught, the distance between the central maximum and the first minimum on the screen will be given by L p y divided by m v x. Now, I would also use this particular, I will also calculate this y naught using the wave theory, because that is what is the concept of wave particle duality. This y naught is being calculated using uncertainty principle. I will calculate also y naught from the pure wave theory. I will equate the two, and then I will find to try to correlate and find out what will be the uncertainty expression. So, now we know that for the first maximum, the angular separation will be given by d sin theta is equal to lambda. That is the standard diffraction formula that again we know at the high school. Now, let us assume that theta is very small, then sin theta can be approximately written as theta. Okay, of course, theta has to be expressed in radians. So, this expression becomes theta d is equal to lambda. Now, theta d, as you can see that theta will be given by y naught by L. Let me go back to this. Theta will be given by y naught by L. Remember, the theta has to be expressed in radians. If I write sin theta is equal to theta, that is valid only when theta is in radians, and this will be given by y naught by L. So, this is y naught upon L into d. This must be equal to lambda. Okay. This lambda by de Broglie relationship has to be given by h by momentum. So, I am assuming that v y component is very, very small. So, momentum is totally given by only the x component. So, this I can approximately write as h upon m v x. So, using this relationship, I can calculate what is y naught. I will multiply this by L and divide by this d. So, y naught will be given by h times L, okay, divided by m v x, and this d will also go into the denominator. So, this will become h L upon m v x d. So, I have obtained two values of y naught, two expressions for y naught. This expression for y naught was using purely a diffraction, purely a wave property. Earlier, I have found a y naught assuming an uncertainty principle. Of course, I have not used any particular form of uncertainty principle. I have only used that how this uncertainty principle will cause a y component of the velocity to develop. Now, I equate these two y two, then try to look at the uncertainties and obtain what will be the uncertainty product. So, we equate the two values of y naught. So, one I had obtained earlier using uncertainty principle, this is using wave nature. Okay. If you put this particular thing, what you will find out, this L into m v x will cancel. So, here you will have only p y, and here you will have this L will also cancel. So, here you will have will be equal to 1 upon d, and there will be h here, which does not cancel out. Okay. So, L cancels out, m v x cancels out. So, you have here p y, here you have h upon d. So, this implies p y into d must be equal to h. Now, if both these relations have to be same, then this expression must be valid. Now, this d I can identify it as the uncertainty in the y direction, and this p y is the momentum component of the y in the y direction, which has been picked up due to the uncertainty in the momentum. So, this I can identify as the uncertainty in momentum. So, we can see that delta p y into delta y must be equal to h. So, take approximately d as the uncertainty in y and p y as the uncertainty in the momentum, then we can write delta y delta p y is of the order of h. So, this is what we see, that the value of Planck's constant turns out to be very, very small. Maybe some of you would like to mention to your students a very wonderful book written by George Gamow, which is it's called Mr. Tompkins in the Wonderland. And this is about a student who starts learning about the modern physics, and there are various chapters in this particular book. One of the chapter talks about a quantum jungle, where a particular person goes to hunt in the jungle, and there the value of Planck's constant is very, very large, and then the lion comes, and because of uncertainty principle, the person is not able to find out where the lion is. It's a very wonderful reading book, a very nice way of representing what would have happened if Planck's constant would have been very, very large in our real life, and we would have started seeing uncertainty in our daily life. Similarly, there is another chapter on relativity, where it talks of a bird where the velocity of light is exceedingly small, and in that case you will start seeing relativistic effects in your daily life. Then how the life would look like, it is a very, very interesting picturization of that particular thing. Now let us actually define uncertainty. In fact, some of the people have even asked this question, that you are talking in a very, very hand-waving way. Okay. Now this is the time when we will start going from quantum ideas to more formal quantum mechanics. Of course, once we actually use a wave function, we will also talk about the uncertainties. At least in one specific case, we will definitely talk about it. But now let us go to a little more definiteness. A uncertainty product is defined as the standard deviation in whatever particular expression that we are talking. If we are talking of uncertainty in position, essentially it means that you make measurement of position of that particular particle n number of times, then you take the standard deviation of the position value. When you take the standard deviation, whatever is the standard deviation that you get will be called the uncertainty in that particular component, or uncertainty in x in this particular case, the example which I have given you. All right. So this is the way we exactly define uncertainty principle, uncertainties. Then it can also be shown, which we will not be showing, that of course uncertainty product always depends on the type of the wave packet that we have got, and different wave packets will have different minimum uncertainty product. But it can be shown that the absolute least value of uncertainty product that you can get for any wave packet is delta x delta px greater than or equal to h cross by 2. And this happens for a Gaussian wave packet, which you get in the case of harmonic oscillators, okay, which probably is beyond the scope of this particular course. But just to mention that h cross by 2 is purely absolute minimum. So you will not be able to find out wave packet in which delta x and delta px product is smaller than h cross by 2. Then there are various other uncertainty principle. One of the other important uncertainty principle is time energy uncertainty principle. So remember, when we are talking about the wave packet, we were talking of it being limited both in position as well as in time. All the examples that we have given so far, we have limited the wave packet only in position. We have not bothered about limiting the wave packet in time. If I limit the wave packet in time domain, in that case, almost whatever we have said about position also becomes true for the time. Okay. And therefore, we get, because remember, in the case of the wave, when you are writing the expression for wave, k and x comes together. Okay. So, there is an uncertain relationship between k and x. This k is related to wavelength, x is related to the position, omega is related to frequency, and t is related to time. Okay. Now, this omega is also related to energy, because of h cross omega is supposed to give you energy. Therefore, this, if you limit the wave packet in time domain, this creates an uncertainty between energy and the time, exactly in the same way as it creates an uncertainty between position and the momentum. So, you have other uncertainties. Let us come back to the lectures. So, for example, if an electron spends a very short time in an excited state before a spontaneous emission, then the time spread of the emitted wave cannot be larger than the time it has spent on the excited state. Therefore, it causes a spread in its energy, and then you find the value of energy of a photon which is emitted is also uncertain, and it is also, so to say, broadened. So, this is called time energy uncertainty principle. So, we have various type of uncertainty principle which I have listed here. Delta x delta px is of the order of is greater than equal to h cross by 2, delta y delta py greater than equal to h cross by 2. Remember, delta x is always related to delta px. Delta x is not related to delta py. Similarly, delta y is related to delta py. It's not related to delta py, px, or delta pz. So, delta x delta px is greater than equal to h cross by 2. These are the various uncertainty principle which are essentially useful as far as this particular part of the course is concerned. Now, let us go a little ahead before I start taking questions. We have essentially completed what we call as the quantum ideas. We are coming now more closer to the formal quantum mechanics. See, remember, when we talk of the classical particle, we talk of Newton's law of motion that describes the behavior of the classical particle. When I talk of the wave nature, we generally talk of a wave equation. Now, we have something here when we are talking about quantum particles which behave something like particles and sometimes like waves. Okay. What should be the equation which should describe the behavior of this particular type of, a dual particle wave? So, let us like to look at this particular thing. Look out for new laws. Let us try to look out for new laws, okay, how to go ahead. Okay. I mean, whatever we have talked in the quantum ideas, most were phenomenological. Bohr model, angular momentum quantization, which of course is not correct today, was given purely phenomenologically. There was no logic, it was never derived from a theory. Okay. For example, if I have to discuss the energy levels of not hydrogen atom but some other complicated atom, I do not know how to do, because it was not derived from any basic equation. Okay. Now I would like to form my laws. I would like to know what is the equation which governs this particular particle, so that in general I can say that, like Newton's law of motion will describe the behavior of classical particle, it is this equation which will describe the behavior of wave particle dual. Okay, something in a particle which has a significant wave properties, significant or rather observable wave properties. Okay, what is the equation which governs that? Okay, so we are essentially in dark, we do not know how to proceed. Okay, so we are trying to form our ideas. Let us be very clear, the equation that we are going to land up, as all of you know, the Schrodinger equation. We are not trying to derive Schrodinger equation. So many of the arguments that I am going to give are not probably unquestionable. There can always be questions which can be raised. Okay. But on the other hand, why we believe on Schrodinger equation? Because from Schrodinger equation, whatever we obtain, okay, they are at least as of now are experimentally verified. That's why we believe in Schrodinger equation. I am not deriving Schrodinger equation. I am just putting some arguments how I am reaching at that particular equation. A real test of any theory is whether it can explain the experiments. Okay. If it explains the experiments, then we take that particular theory. If it cannot explain, we reject that particular theory. So now let's look for the two I laws. This is what is called Newton's law of motion. Force is equal to mass into acceleration, and acceleration, you know, in the differential form can be written as the second derivative of time of position vector d2r dt square. This is the standard wave equation, which if you are not very familiar, this is standard wave equation which you normally will obtain in the case of, let's say, electromagnetic theory by using Maxwell's equation. I think Professor Ghosh will cover probably, I'm not very sure about the electromagnetic waves. The thing is that, can I pick one of these two equations and say that this is the equation which will also govern the behavior of the particle nature of, I mean, a particle which has a wave nature. Okay. But before I do that, let me just sort of convince. First of all, I will say that this particular equation I will reject, because there is nothing like wave property here, it is purely particle behavior. But this particular equation does have a wave behavior. So let us first try to understand, let us first try to convince ourselves that this particular equation is satisfied by the standard wave equation. Because remember, in some of the earlier transparencies, we have just written the wave equation psi is equal to a sin kx minus omega t. Okay? But let us first convince ourselves that that particular expression is actually a solution of this particular equation. So my question is, first, which is the equation that governs a non-relativistic particle? This I must emphasize again, Schrodinger equation talks of only in non-relativistic limit. Okay, we are always assuming that the speed of the particle is much smaller than the speed of light. Okay, a non-relativistic particle with observable wave behavior. The first one does not imply wave nature at all. So should I check? Let's check at the second equation. Let us see from second equation, first of all, whether the second equation will work. Okay, if it does not work, can I get some hint from the second equation and arrive at an equation which probably will be valid for the particles with observable wave behavior. Now, before I go ahead, I mean, I have written four different forms, or there can be many more forms, in which a wave type of solutions are possible. Okay, a sin kx minus omega t I have used. Some of you had asked that why I don't use minus sin kx minus omega t. That's also another form, except in that particular case, the wave will have a phase difference with respect to this particular wave. Okay, this particular wave, cosine kx minus omega t, is also a proper wave. Okay, again, there is a phase difference between this particular and this particular wave. If you want to plot, let's say, at a given time as a function of x, you will find that these two waves will differ in phase by pi by 2. At this moment, I would like to introduce exponential form of representing a wave. Okay, this is actually a complex form, a e raised power I kx minus omega t, and as you can, you know that this thing can be written as a cos kx minus omega t plus I sin kx minus omega t. All right. Now, this is actually a mixture of a sine term and complex term, but more surprisingly, this is a sine term and a cosine term, but more surprisingly, it has also an I, and this I is equal to under root minus 1, as all of you know, which makes it imaginary. Okay. Now, one can always thought of a wave, something which is always a real. So how can I represent it by a complex number? But those people who are students of electrical engineering, they know that's very, very commonly done in electrical circuits. Even we are talking about LCR circuits, etc. We definitely represent these oscillations in the form of an exponential form with a I, with an imaginary number. Okay, and this is, the thing is, so long it's the observable things are real, it does not matter whether I am using a complex number. Okay, there of course we are always talking about the real part, and the imaginary part sort of represents a phase. So it's very, very common, at least in many of the circuits, to represent a wave-like solution by an equation of this particular sort. Now, first thing which I would like to show, that both these, all these solutions will satisfy the wave equation which I have just now written, this, which is this equation. Remember, this links second derivative of x with the second derivative of time, and this c is supposed to be constant, which I will actually identify this as the phase velocity of the wave. Of course, this c will be actual velocity of light c only when this is an electromagnetic wave, otherwise this c will represent the velocity of an appropriate wave. Okay, so let's just take two of these terms just to satisfy yourself that this is actually a proper way of representing the wave. So let's first take sin kx minus omega t. So I take first the position derivative. So remember, these are partial derivative. So when I am taking derivative with respect to x, okay, t has to be treated as constant. So when I take the first derivative, you will get my cosine will become sine, and because you are taking derivative with respect to k, so there will be a. There will be k which will be coming, derivative with respect to x, sorry. So, a k will come out here. So, you will have del psi del x is equal to minus a k sin k x minus omega t. When you take derivative for the second time, this sine will again become cos. Okay, another k term will come here. Okay, it will become minus a k square sin k x minus omega t. Remember, derivative of cosine will include have a negative sign, but derivative of sine will not have a negative sign. So, this negative sign will always remain. Now, this is the second order derivative with respect to position. Let us try to take the second derivative with respect to the time. Okay, so I did take derivative with respect to time. So again cosine becomes sine. Okay, but there was a negative sign here, and time term there is another negative sign here. So this becomes plus. So this becomes a w sine kx minus omega t. I take the second derivative. Now again, because of this negative sign, a negative sign comes here, is minus a w square is equal to cos kx minus omega t. I substitute in this particular equation, the wave equation, which was del 2 psi del x square is equal to 1 upon c square del 2 psi del t square. Okay, you will find that all these terms cancel out, and all you get is c square is equal to, there will be omega square, and there is a k square here, will be equal to omega square by k square. And as you know, omega by k is the phase velocity of this wave. So, this c represents the phase velocity of this particular wave. So, as you can see that this particular solution actually satisfies the equation, the wave equation. So, this is actually a solution of this particular equation. Now, let us take one exponential form, this particular form. This is actually much easier. Once I take the derivative with respect to x, exponential form remains in the exponential form. Only thing, this ik will come out here. When I take the second derivative, it will be minus ak square into this particular thing. Now, I take derivative with respect to time. When I take the derivative with respect to time, first time when I take derivative, I get minus ai, this exponential form remains. Second time I take the derivative, I get minus a omega square this term. I substitute in this equation, I get c square is equal to omega square by k square, exactly the same thing. So, we are actually getting exactly the same speed of light, same speed of the particle, same speed of the wave, sorry, okay, irrespective of whether I am using this particular term or that particular term. Similarly, I could have taken the other two terms, and there also I would have found that these solutions also satisfy the wave equation. Now, I will just stop. If you have some questions, you know, we will probably try to take some questions for another 10 minutes, and we will choose randomly from some of the centers, some of the questions. Those centers which do not have questions, probably if they want to leave, they can leave. And then other questions, you know, people should post us, and like before, we will try to answer in the next lecture.
Okay, MES Pillai.
Hello sir, my question is…
Yes, please go ahead.
Can we get interference pattern with single electron in double slit experiment, as electron is associated with…
See, the thing is that the wave is associated with single electron, there is no question of interference pattern, because this electron is going to land somewhere. See, in order to see interference pattern, you have to have multiple electrons. Okay. In fact, I can refer to a website which probably I will upload separately in Moodle, where where you can see the video of this particular the experiment which has been done, which has been recently done, I mean not very recently but something like 10-15 years back by a group in Japan, okay, where they have performed this particular experiment where electrons really come one by one, and when it comes by one it lands somewhere, okay, when the second electron comes it again lands somewhere. So you will not be able to see interference pattern in that sense. But when you are started seeing a very large number of electrons, then only you will start seeing that this how the interference pattern starts building up. So for first few electrons, you will not be able to see because they are essentially coming and falling there randomly. In fact, using cold gases, you know, and there is a great work of Professor Cohen, Tanuji, etc. Using the cold gases, it has been possible to perform these type of diffraction experiments, which originally were thought only as a thought experiments, but recently it has been possible to perform these experiments, and you can really show that once the particles are coming one by, and they are coming so slowly that there is no possibility of them interacting with each other. Okay, so one particular particle comes and lands somewhere, second particle comes again lands somewhere, okay, because there is some probability of landing it somewhere. Okay, unless you have very large number of particles, you will not start seeing the interference pattern.
Don Bosco.
I have two questions.
Yes, yes.
The first question is, yes, can we interpret the electron diffraction pattern as, yes, some sort of a probability distribution function?
That's right. That's what I am eventually going to interpret it like that, because probably I am not very sure in this particular lecture or in the next lecture, tomorrow's lecture, I will try to interpret what is the wave function, and then I will interpret this as a probability wave. So actually it is a representation of the probabilities. Well, you are 100% right.
Okay, sir. So, and my second question is, the electron diffraction pattern, I am just assuming that it is a sinc square function.
Yes.
So, which is, we know that it is a very well behaved function.
Yes, that's right.
So, the slide number 18,
yes,
you had mentioned two words, that is random and unpredictable and uncontrolled.
Uncontrolled, yes, that's right. You are right.
Yes, sir.
You go
so
ahead.
So, these two, so now if the sinc square function, which is a well defined function, so it means, and if you interpret it as a probability distribution function,
yes, yes,
then this unpredictable and uncontrolled behavior, it holds good only for a single electron. So
yes,
am I to understand that the unpredictability holds good for only a single electrons, but when we have a statistically large number of electrons,
that's right,
then the behavior becomes more and more predictable?
That's right. You are right in that sense also. See, thing is that, you know, when we are talking about a single particle, you are right. See, the question is that when I am trying to talk of unpredictability there, okay, it's essentially relating to the comparing with the classical mechanics. In classical mechanics, if you have 1,000,000 particle and they have same initial condition, they have exactly the same force, all of them are going to land up exactly at the same position after a given time. Okay, there is complete 100% predictability in classical mechanics. Now, when a particular individual particle is coming here, I do not know where this particular particle is going to land up. So, in that sense, there is unpredictability. But you are sure, you are perfectly right that if I perform this, and this is basically statistics, if I perform this experiment on, let's say, 1,000,000 particle, okay, then you will find that the probability that you are getting are well defined. Okay, so I am getting a well defined, it is almost like any probability experiment. Okay, if I perform, you know, if I just toss a coin, I will either get head or tail. Okay, so I cannot find out whether the probability of getting head is half or probability of getting tail is half. Okay, it's also possible that you toss a coin 3 times. Okay, and all the 3 times you may get head. Okay, it does not mean the probability is not half. Okay, you have to perform this experiment over a large number of coins to really see that the probability is half. So, well-defined probability, whenever I am talking, is not because of an individual experiment. I have to perform this experiment over a large number of particles, then only I will be able to get the idea of probability. But what you get, you are 100% right again, that when what I am getting eventually also from Schrodinger equation is a probability, and these are the well-defined probabilities. So, like in classical mechanics, I get a predictability about the position or momentum, here I get predictability only about the probability.
Okay, Thakur College.
Hello.
Yeah, yes. Go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I have two questions.
Yes.
First one.
Yes.
Can you elaborate Heisenberg uncertainty principle,
yeah,
that is applicable to angle and angular momentum?
That's
so
right.
How it is?
And okay.
Second is,
yeah,
explain probability density function.
See, probability density function I will explain in my subsequent lectures. So, I will avoid answering this question at this particular moment. Okay, because I'm going to spend quite a bit of time explaining what I mean by probability, what I mean by the wave function. Okay, so therefore, let's postpone this question about this thing. About the theta and angular momentum, okay, you are perfectly right. There is an uncertainty principle lies. Okay, there are a large number of pairs among which uncertainty principle can be seen. Okay, what I am trying to show here is only a very, very elementary way of looking into quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics, once you go in advanced quantum mechanics, not only quantum mechanics becomes, you know, fairly, let's say abstract, okay, it also becomes mathematically fairly complex. Then you can define the pairs, on which there will be an uncertainty principle which will be existing, or define a pair of two dynamical quantities in which an uncertainty principle will exist. And there is a definite way of looking at a commutative operator, how it can be done. Okay, but that's again a part of the advanced quantum mechanics course.
Hello.
Yes. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, in order to give an example of application of uncertainty principle, we could able to prove delta x delta p is equals to h stars.
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Why we can. Can we prove this, the another conjugate also, that delta E, delta T is also using the single slit diffraction or any other kind of explanations we need to look
at? You are talking about delta E, delta T uncertainty principle. Are you talking about delta E, delta T uncertainty
principle? Delta E, delta T. We have three, delta X, delta P, delta E, delta T, delta theta and L. So can we prove using only one single example all these three?
I'm not very sure with it can be done. See, let's also understand that, you know, the way I'm sort of introducing this are sort of an approximate way, because, or let me put it like a hand waving wave. So the examples which I'm giving are purely more or less hand waving. As I said, you know, using advanced quantum mechanics, all these things are much better formalized, but they become a little more abstract. So at least I cannot think immediately of any particular example which can simultaneously give all the uncertainty principles at one go.
My mean, sir, if you have the momentum like in classical mechanics, we could able to find out some energy kind of parameters. Whereas in quantum mechanics, if I'm having uncertainty of momentum, why can't we find uncertainty in energy?
We can definitely find uncertainty in energy.
These two products.
See, the thing is that,
is
you know.
It made these two.
Yeah, please go ahead.
The pairs, the conjugate pairs which we made here,
yes,
as a products are just to satisfy the dimensional analysis it is formed, or really they are giving three of us together any collective information or productive information about a quantum mechanical system, all these six parameters together, because I'm interested about a system regarding all these parameters simultaneously or individually. However, but all six, I want how to find out that.
No, see, I'm not very sure whether I have understood your question properly, but let me try to explain whatever I have understood. See, thing is that, let me first talk about energy and time uncertainty. Energy and time uncertainty, most commonly it's used when we are saying that whenever you are taking a particular beam of monochromatic light or X-rays for that matter, can never be 100% monochromatic. There is always a width in the energy, and therefore, I mean, and that's related to the basically the lifetime spent, the lifetime of the state, the de-excitation of which has resulted into that particular photon. So, but if I understand, I mean, see, as I again say, that these conjugate pairs that you have talked, okay, can be defined, okay, it's not only the dimensional analysis, of course, the dimensional analysis is an important thing, because once they are of the order of H cross, dimensionally they have to match, the product has to match H cross, but they are defined from little more fundamental way, which comes from basically commutator rules in the quantum mechanics, okay, which is a part of a little more abstract and little more, mathematical. So these are the uncertainty principles which you can define simply by looking at the wave packet thing. See, as probably you are aware, that the wave mechanics way of representing quantum mechanics is also one of the ways. Okay, we need not talk about the wave mechanics. We can talk purely about from the operator point of view. Okay, we can talk of purely operator mechanics, which is a different way of looking at quantum mechanics, okay, which is much more general and much more profound. But see, here what I am giving is a purely from the wave mechanics aspect, a feeling of high uncertainty principle should arise. But you are right in that sense that a more rigorous valuation of uncertainty principle, okay, has to be done by taking more advanced quantum mechanics and taking proper conjugate pairs. You are right.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Yes, NIT Rourkela.
Yes, please go ahead.
Sir, my question is why the wave function is expressed both in real and imaginary form? Why imaginary part is required?
That I am actually in the afternoon lecture, that's what I am going to describe, because the equation that I am going to get can only be solved by a complex number. It cannot be solved by a real number. So automatically all the wave functions become complex. So this particular thing aspect I am going to describe quite a bit in detail in the afternoon lecture.
Meghnatsa Institute.
Sir, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
In single slit diffraction experiment, there is an expression y0 is equal to L Vy by Vx.
That's right.
How can you get this? So can you explain once again?
Yeah, sure. This was my slit and this was my screen, and the distance between this is L. Okay. So if a particle starts from this particular point with a speed Vx, let me write little bit bigger, Vx, then time that it will take to reach here will be L divided by Vx. Is it all right? All right. Now, when this particular particle is moving from here and going here, at that time it is also getting displaced in this particular direction because of the y component of the velocity. So, if I have to find out, if I have a particle which has velocity Vy component in the y direction, then the total time in which it travels is this much time. Okay, how much it gets displaced, so this must be multiplied by Vy. So, this will be the displacement of the particle in this particular direction here, which I am calling as Y naught. Okay, this is the total time the particle will take to travel from this particular slit to this screen. During this time, it is not only moving this direction, but it is also moving upwards or downwards in the Y direction. Okay, and how much it moves, it depends on what is the velocity component in the y direction, okay, multiplied by the time. So, this is the time multiplied by Vy.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Coming to uncertainty relationship.
Yes.
In case if we take del x del p on one side.
Yes.
On the other side, we are seeing many representations like h or h cross or
that's
h cross by 2.
That's right.
Sometimes approximately equation we are using, or sometimes the greater than or equal to we are using.
Yes.
Which
is
the exact form of the uncertainty relation?
See, as I said, the exact form depends purely on the wave function. And eventually I will derive for a particle in a box the uncertainty expression. Okay. So, because in fact a large number of problems that we do on uncertainty principle, especially at the first year level, are actually using an approximate expression just to get a feeling of the uncertainty principle. So, we do not bother about what expression that I am using. Only thing which I want to say, that it can be shown that for irrespective of the wave packet that you use, you will never get a uncertainty product which is less than h cross by 2. Okay, but depends, once I solve Schrodinger equation, I will get a particular type of wave function or what we call as a wave packet. Okay, and corresponding to that wave packet, there will be a corresponding uncertainty principle.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, I have a question regarding the dual nature of the light.
Yes.
Is it always necessary to analyze particle and wave nature for the applications that we are using today? And which is the nature which dominates for most of the applications involving light nowadays?
See, that as I said, you know, it always depends on the type of application that you are talking. Okay, and now domination is not really a correct word, because it depends on what type of device dominates in our life. Okay, so it's not, as I mentioned, there is supposed to be a sort of complementarity principle which says that, you know, both the particle nature and wave nature cannot be simultaneously observed in an experiment. And as I have also mentioned today morning, that this particular complementarity principle is under observation. There are some groups who have been working, researching on this thing. In fact, I have also seen some papers where people are talking that this particular principle does not hold good. But as far as I know, this has not yet been established that this complementary principle does not necessarily work. So, as of now, I am taking that it works. And if it works, then you cannot in a device see both the aspects together. Now, it again depends on what type of device that you are talking. Okay. For example, if I am talking of semiconductor device, I find it very, very convenient that there is a photon which gets absorbed and creates, let us say, electron hole pair. Okay. And we do not talk in terms of really wave nature. So again, it depends, you know, and depends on what type of device is much more useful to you to talk which effect is more dominant. But let me put it like that, depends on what type of experiment and what type of device that you are working, whether you will have a wave nature or a particle nature. Yeah, you have one more question? Yes. Yes, madam.
Yes, sir, I have one more question.
Yes, please.
As we know that electromagnetic wave is different from mechanical wave associated with the particle.
Yeah.
So, can we say that wave-particle duality, which is applicable to electromagnetic wave, is analogous to uncertainty principle used for particle?
Well, I'm not very sure whether I have understood your question. See, if you are talking of mechanical wave, I'm not talking of mechanical wave. Okay, when I'm talking of wave-particle duality, I'm talking specifically of electromagnetic waves. Okay, I'm not sure whether we can talk about wave-particle duality in the case of, let's say, water wave, or for that matter, let's say, sound wave. Okay, I don't think we can do it. So, when we are talking of this duality, I mean, when we are talking of this particular, I mean, see, for example, sound requires a medium to travel. Okay, this is very, very different from the wave, the electromagnetic wave. Okay, so when we are talking of this dual nature of photon and particles, and in terms of, you know, zero rest mass particle, okay, we are talking specifically in terms of the electromagnetic waves.
Okay, sir.
Sir, one question.
Yeah.
Does the uncertainty principle imply the existence of particles that exceed the speed of light?
No, there is nothing, no relation with the speed of light. See, the particles that we are talking never travels with the speed of light. In principle, a massive particle cannot travel with the speed of light. So, speed of light has no role to play in quantum mechanics. In principle, the Schrodinger quantum mechanics is always non-relativistic. So, I'm little surprised why you are talking about the speed of light at all. I mean, maybe I have not understood your question, but you know. So, can you repeat your question? I'm a little, yeah.
Does the uncertainty principle imply the existence of particles that exceed the speed of light?
That exit? That exceed the speed,
of light.
No. It's nothing to do with the speed of light. No, I'm sorry. Absolutely nothing. See, uncertainty principle is always talking of only the probability of finding the particle and probability of finding its momentum. Okay? There's nothing, no role of speed of light here. I think we'll sort of stop here. Then any other questions you have, you know, please send it by in the chat mode. We'll try to answer in the next lectures. Thank you very much.